Good afternoon and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It's Wednesday night and we are live.
What the fuck was that music?
What music? When?
There's some gay piano stuff playing.
When? Oh, that's because you are on the stream. You can probably hear us in a second. That's what we play before we come on the show. It's just some open stuff. Okay. Anyway, hello and welcome everybody. You can see we've all got fucking stupid hats on. Because it's our birthday.
Speak for yourself.
Okay. Steve's got his king hat on. He's got his the crown that he was given last time he was.
It's braids. It looks like he's wrapped in an elaborate baguette.
It's
why are you dressed like Roger the Cabin Boy from Captain Planet?
I'm dressed like Billy Elliot.
And whereas Sam is dressed like a Jew, basically.
Oi! Hey.
Whereas I put a little bit of effort into my custom design. I've got a nice little Resonance Arcade logo going on.
Can we see that up close? Yeah, we...
A little,
can we see yours up close, Sam?
Little happy...
Yes, I was going to say my design is exquisite and very well thought out. Come on.
So yes, this is a very special episode for us, at least. Anyway, I know most of you probably don't care too much, but we've had a full year on the air now. We are on episode 48. We haven't had 52 episodes. We obviously had 4 weeks off at some point throughout the year, and we can only apologise for that, of course. But you know what? Yeah, we all need a break. I think we all had holidays, etc. We're changing it up a little bit tonight. We haven't got too much else to talk about, but we're just going to talk about what's gone on over the last year on the show. Things that we've enjoyed, the games that have come out that are cool, and that's about it. So in tradition, we usually start with talking about what we've played with. Oh God. I can't get over me. I'm looking at myself. I haven't actually seen myself with this hat on before now, and it's a bit ridiculous. So
the cone is a little bit flat.
I was saying to the guys before the show started, I was concerned I was going to be the only one with a hat on, and I was concerned that they wouldn't be able to take me seriously. One, they probably don't take me seriously anyway, to start off with. And two, I can't take myself seriously looking at myself for this. I need to turn the camera off so I can't see myself. So yes, we normally talk about what we played this week. I've played quite a few games, but I'll let you guys lead. Steve, I believe you've had a bit of a bash on some of the games.
Getting towards the end of The Witcher 3 now, which I'm finding... I don't want to let go.
Do you not want to let go because you've completed it or because you're enjoying it? Because
I'm enjoying the experience, and I'm enjoying the universe, and I'm just enjoying it in general. I haven't really got to put as much... Well, I say that. I haven't been able to put as much time in consecutively as I would like to. So it's been a little bit here, a little bit there. And I'm just kind of... I'm still riding on a high with it, really. So, in true geek fashion, I've decided to start from the beginning.
Yeah. How are you feeling The Witcher 1, though? Because when I played it...
The control interface is so bad.
So awful, isn't it?
It's terrible. And like, going back to it, it gives my fingers cancer just thinking about it.
But it's not just that. It's that it's literally a timed click fight, yeah. Isn't it? It's not much... There's not much skill to it. I mean, can you dodge, even?
Yeah, you've got a double tap one of the direction keys.
Right, and
parry as well if you time it right.
But if I remember rightly, when you double tap, it's just like literally a sidestep to the left or to the right. There's nothing. There's nothing as dynamic as there is in Witcher 3.
But the story's still there, and the interaction's still there. The characters, you know, you're still getting the likes of like Vesemir, Esco, and Lambert, and all that. They still play a big part in it.
Is Yennefer in the first one?
Yennefer doesn't really... I don't think she appears in the first one, or she's only referred to.
Okay. Does he still talk to the things like, come on, come closer. What now, you piece of filth?
It's the same guy who does the voiceovers, I think, in all three of them.
All right.
Good. Cool.
One of the more entertaining things that I forgot about the original is just how massively misogynistic it is.
They're all a bit like that, though. I mean, even 3's got a lot of misogyny in it.
Well, 3 is nowhere near as bad as the first one. Oh, well, walking around and there's just boobs everywhere.
I was thinking that 3's actually... It's got elements where there's, like, women are sexualized in it, but whatever they do that, they do it to Geralt as well.
Yeah.
And, like...
Yeah, he's
also
walking around with his top off and...
Well, they've made quite a few points in the story to show that, like, there's women that are valuable, that are to still fight... Because it's a fantasy setting and it's obviously, like, the old rules.
Yeah.
Like, women fighting to have their place. Like, there's a bit when you get to Skellige of... a son and a daughter who are both vying for like the kingship of Skellige, and that's quite an interesting story because she's as valuable as he is.
That's what I was.
She's a girl.
That's what I was talking about when we first started talking about the Witcher and sexualization. That particular character, she's quite boisterous though. At the same time, she's different. She's quite pretty, but she's also quite different. If you know what I mean, she's not the typical, you know, beautiful maiden that you have in the, for the other the other female characters in that game, or the other female main characters rather. Mm. But, I haven't played it this week. I haven't played Witcher 3 this week, and
that didn't last very long.
I'm extremely close to the end of the game, so whenever I do play the Witcher 3, at the minute I'm just trying to mop up stuff. I'm trying to get all the question marks in the Skellige Isles and make sure I've got all the master equipment and the master. I'm just dragging it out for as long as
I've already got all that, but I'm basically I got to Skellige. And then I've completed everything on Velen. That's all finished, and all in Novigrad. That's all done. And I did about two quests in Skellige. I met Yennefer, and then we found where there's a mage that basically Ciri's transported back to Velen or something. That's where I've stopped. So I haven't done anything since then.
So you still got you probably still got another 30% to go.
Probably, yeah. I mean, I haven't been trying to complete the game, but as I said, I was hammering it a while back, but now there's so many other games I'm playing at the moment.
So yeah, I've been hammering dice poker in the original Witcher and trying to collect as many cards. Well, every time you sleep with a woman in the original Witcher, you get a trading card. So I'm
In real life.
Aside from that, the only other game I've played really is the Ocarina of Time 3D for the 3DS.
I wanted to ask about that, how they implement the 3D into that specifically. Like,
it works quite well, to be honest. They've updated the graphics from the N64 version. Draw distance is a lot further. You don't get that kind of like the thick brown mist you used to get on the N64 when things go over a certain distance away.
It's been that long since I played the N64 version. My memory of that game is amazing graphics.
it has a look to it and a style, but it's not by today's standards anywhere near what you call good graphically. There's some pretty dodgy textures in it.
The 3DS version, they have updated the graphics and they have, you know, the textures are a little bit higher quality and the models have got a little bit more detail. It's the same mechanics, so things move the same, respond the same, so it's essentially the same game, just with a bit of a facelift.
Right.
The 3D does work quite well, but when I was playing it, I was playing it on a train, and with the 3D on the 3DS, and unless you can hold it at a constant distance away from your face, perfectly still, the 3D tends to like to jump into kind of like a double vision if you're moving it, so I had to switch the 3D off.
So you're just playing an updated version of the original.
Just playing an updated version of the Ocarina of Time. Yeah.
But it's still a great game.
It's still a good game, yeah.
From my memory, at least, of it. I think that was, again, that's one of the few games that I have 100%ed, that I got every single...
I never 100%ed Ocarina or Majora's Mask.
I played Majora's Mask for maybe about 2 hours, but I didn't get into that much.
The two things that I never fully completed was getting all the golden skulltulars, because I just couldn't be bothered like doing them all. I didn't get all the heart pieces, although I probably tied to the skulltular thing. And there was one more. Oh yeah, catching all the ghosts, all the pose in Hyrule Field was just really tedious, and I just gave up on doing that as well.
I 100%ed all of that on that game because I loved it so much. It was one of them few. It was one of the few games that when I started playing, I was fixated on it. Like I am with The Witcher, in fact, but when I was a kid, and it was like, that's all I wanted to do when I came home from school. That's all I wanted to do. There's no wonder I didn't have a girlfriend until I was a late bloomer.
Anyway. For those who want to remember what the original looked like,
let's have a quick look.
Just pasted a link in chat, and you can see what I mean about the draw distance.
Ah, right, yeah.
It's like you're playing it inside stew.
But there's been several improvements made, and it just makes it so that it's, in fact, I'll paste this in, and this is a like for like, the N64 versus the 3DS.
Oh, very nice.
So everything has been updated, but it's still essentially the same game.
They've even updated models, etc. as well, haven't they?
Mm.
Yeah. That looks all right, that.
It's more than playable.
Well, there's that dude without any eyes in the background.
Well, I played through the Ocarina of Time, like about, I think, not shortly before we started doing this show, actually. And obviously, because you know that it's not going to look like fucking Uncharted 3 or whatever. It's just not going to happen. But it's still, once you get into its own world, it's still a nice, it's a nice environment to be in still, that game. It's not unpleasant on your eyes. It's not like, oh God, what were they thinking?
That's what I've kind of found going back to the original Witcher. I mean, I think that was released in 2007. And when you first started playing it, like, very aware that the graphics are not as advanced. But after a while, you just kind of forget about all that and you just get into the story.
Yeah.
So has anyone else played anything then this week? No, just you've been playing some Witcher again, Sam?
I have been playing The Witcher quite a lot this week. Just nothing new to say about it other than I still love The Witcher.
So where are you up to then?
I'm in Skellige. I've been going around doing random... I'm taking this off. I'm going around doing random bits and pieces. Done one mission of the main quest, and then I keep getting... It's one of those games as well, but I got to Skellige and just had like 100 different people going, "Oi, Witcher!" Or, "Oi, Witcher! Oi, Witcher, over here!" So I go over and they're like, "Ah, my dad's got off and died. Find his corpse or something." And I'm like, "Okay, how much will you pay me for that?" And I then found, go and do that.
I found a possessed sheep in the cave or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, I went into Yorkshire then, into cave.
Into cave!
It may not look it, but this crown is incredibly warm.
Yeah, well, I'm absolutely sweating my tits off with this little hat on. I think all of my body heat is forming.
I want to see a little steam thing come from the top of it. You look like a tin man with a tin.
I feel like it's crushing my head though. I think like I'm going all red because I've got a makeshift string strap here, as you can see. And it's oh right, it's come off now. Anyway, there's the hat. I'm not going to leave it on because I'm almost dead. And
we should give that away as a prize to one of the viewers.
Well, I'll tell you what. If someone, Chris, we'll do a little competition later on, maybe, and we'll.
Do we have any viewers?
We've got a few people in the chat that just haven't said hello yet.
I think they're stunned at the hats.
Yeah, they're stunned at the hats. Right. So, yeah, I've played a few games. I played a few games that I was playing last week. So I played a bit more Teleglitch Dimebore Edition. I basically keep getting to the same bloody point. Last week I said that you can play the first three levels, or three procedurally generated levels, and then you open up level three. But in fact, what you have to do is actually play the first five levels, then you open up level three. So yeah, it unlocks level three, so you can start from three again instead of starting from one. But I haven't actually got to five, I've got to four, and then I get swamped by way too many enemies and don't have enough ammo to kill people. And this is the problem with roguelikes. You have to be very lucky in the loots that you do, you know, in looting crates, etc., in order to get past the next point. So I played it a few times, but I don't know. I'm not sure if I'll keep playing it. It's one of those that's, I can imagine, just going to eat my time up. Played a game called Cortex Command, which I think I played a while back.
I remember seeing this ages ago. It's a good-looking game.
It looks good. It doesn't play very good, though, from my experience of it. I've tried it twice now, but this time I gave it quite a bit more of my time. I think I played maybe 3 or 4 hours. But I played 3 or 4 hours of the tutorial over and over again to try and get my head round how it works. You're a disembodied brain of some sort, and you have to control a load of AI characters. And not AI, obviously, they're controlled by you, but you can set teams up, and you can send, depending on how much money you have, you can send in crate drops, and the crate drops give you things like mounted turrets and additional armor, but there's thousands of items. It's a very like 2D kind of I'd say Terraria-ish game, but it's the much bigger sprites, everything. But I went into the campaign and I tried to figure out how to actually work the campaign and get into a battle, and I couldn't. It's basically this globe that just rotates on your screen. You click next at the bottom like you would in any kind of turn-based strategy game, and then the computer does something, and then it's the next day. And it doesn't really show anything on the screen as to what's happened. So I don't know if it's incomplete or maybe I'm just completely missing the point. So I can't figure it out.
It's been around for a while, that game.
Yeah, but I've had it suggested by a few people now. And they said it's really, really good when you get into it. And it's like, I keep trying to.
From what I've seen, it's some weird combination of Worms, Terraria, XCOM. And a turn-based game. Well, XCOM is a turn-based game, but it's kind of
It's
all those things combined. But the management portion of it, the kind of planet open orbit part of it, is kind of like the XCOM geoscape thing.
Well, it is, but I can't find any extra details surrounding it. I can't figure out how to do anything in the geoscape side of things. So. Don't know. It's one of those. It's like maybe I should just quickly watch a tutorial on YouTube. See,
might be worth watching a Let's Play or something. Yeah,
because it looks like it might be rewarding if I got into it. I think it's going to be quite tactical, but also moving some of the AI characters is really clunky. They're all jointed. You know, they've all got. If you land them too hard, they'll kind of crush into themselves and they'll bounce back up. It feels really weird to move.
I'm pasting pictures into chat because it looks mental. The stuff that's going on is so funny.
That's the tutorial level, that. What the fuck is going on there?
lots is the answer to that.
Yeah, well, it's... yeah, it's... It's maybe worth my time a bit more, but I keep trying. I haven't gotten very far with it. Decided to play Dishonored, the DLC, because you mentioned it last week and it was in my mind. And I've completed the Knife of Dunwall. Didn't take too long, but thoroughly enjoyed it. Couldn't help but kill everybody, or not kill everyone. I couldn't help but incapacitate everyone and pile them up in a little corner. But I noticed that, and I don't know if this is true in the full game, when you pile up bodies in a corner, then you go and kill another guy and drag him to the same place and pile him up again, bodies keep disappearing from that pile. They're not persistent.
I don't recall ever making a pile.
No, me neither. I don't have that fetish, Chris.
It's just something I do in those kind of games. I like to make piles because I know that is a safe spot and no one will discover them, you know. But I still manage to get a couple of discovered bodies occasionally, which is a bit annoying.
I think rats eat them and then it gets tallied at the end of the map.
And I didn't have any killed people.
No, but if you leave corpses around or you leave people sleeping, they can get eaten by rats.
Yeah, they can, okay. But I'm saying that didn't happen to me in this game. I got people found my corpse. I didn't leave corpses around. I left unconscious people around.
Right,
so non-lethal, low chaos.
If you've played through the Knife of Dunwall, which is the first half of it, then you will have done that really cool level where you get to go and see the whale factory interior with a whale in it.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, with a live whale in it as well.
That was really cool, that, because I thought that, because in the main game, and I'm just going to take over your talking about it now because you brought it up, I really liked that they did that because they'd set up this lore of this world, which I was really genuinely intrigued by, with the whole whale oil economy and everything about it and how all the diaries told you about how cruel this practice actually was, and that this whole society was built on this, basically animal cruelty against these huge creatures. I actually thought it was really nice of them to say, this is what whales are like. This is what this whole thing is built on. These are the creatures that are holding this whole society aloft, essentially, because the whale oil was behind, everything in that world.
Yeah, absolutely everything, yeah.
So I thought it was a really good idea that they did that, and I hope they expand on that kind of stuff in the second game.
Now, I haven't replayed the first, the original game, but when you jumped and used Blink, you didn't freeze in midair, did you? Like you did.
Doubt's abilities are slightly different from Corvo's.
Yeah, yeah. So that is different, isn't it? I can't remember that happening in the original.
Yeah, I think I talked about this a while ago when I said I much prefer Doubt's Blink than Corvo's. I think Doubt's is what I wanted out of Blink in the original game. I thought that Blink, because it made it so you could only really use it unless if you were super skilled, as you were falling, which is nigh on impossible to do, or you had to be stationary to use Blink, which kind of, for me, defeated a little bit of the purpose of having a cool teleportation power. The fact that time froze when you were down for Blink made it really cool.
It only freezes if you stop, though. It doesn't freeze. You can still move around if you're using Blink. And you're moving, time doesn't freeze. But if you stop and stop pressing any of the movement keys, that's when it freezes. So if you jumped in the air, everything would be moving. Let go of all the keys and he stops. I did like it. I did prefer it. But it also made me a bit lazy, I think, with some of the tasks. I didn't find it very challenging. And I had it on the hardest setting. It was quite easy, in fact, to get through the game, I think.
I kind of like easy stealth games. I like to feel like I'm some super ninja master assassin that can avoid everyone.
Well, I mean, especially with all the skills, though. I mean, if you didn't have the skills, it's not easy. If you try to do it without any of the skills, then it's very difficult. I also like the fact that you went back to the jail that you started in the first game, and you went basically reverse into the jail, and then you have to come back out again. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was quite cool, actually. I mean, they reused a couple of levels, but they reused them in an interesting way. And the new levels that they put in there, I thought, were really interesting as well.
I agree.
Like, you go, there's some stuff you do in the Witches one as well, which I consider I'm sure I enjoyed the second one more than the first one.
I've played
also because it wraps up the story as well.
I played about an hour, maybe 2 hours of the second one so far. But I still, I mean, I can't remember how much I paid for the DLC. I can't remember when I got it or where I got it from, but I think it was worth it. I put it that way. I think I've enjoyed what I've played so far.
Yeah. I'm still of the opinion that with a game like that, with that kind of world and that kind of story, a voiced protagonist who is actually a character and a person is better. So I kind of enjoyed it for the fact that Dowd was there and he actually spoke about things and thought about things rather than just being Corvo, who was supposed to be an interesting character, but we don't know that because he never says anything or has any feelings about anything.
Do you think he is supposed to be an interesting character, though?
Well, he's supposed to be like the conflict of all where you decide to do this, the fate of the kingdom rests in your hands and this kind of shit. And it's like, well, it would have been interesting to have somebody, a voice actor, or at least some thoughts about that situation.
Reading some of the books in the game, Corvo was chosen by the Empress for being exceptional to be her bodyguard after he's been through a load of trials in order to get to that point where she can choose him. So you would think that he would be an interesting character and have something about him, but yeah, you're right, he doesn't.
Plus, they make a point of the whole outsider saying the outsider only picks those subjects that he deems to be intriguing and interesting and weird enough to spark his interest. Now, Corvo isn't. He's got a history, but it's all told through other people. We never get his view or ideas about any of it. Mm. And I'm hoping that in the sequel, because they're intoning that you can play as Emily or Corvo, that they change that, flip it around. Like in the first Dead Space game, Isaac Clarke just went, didn't speak or have any interactions.
Yeah.
Second game, they gave him a voice and he talked about things and it just made it better. It made you get into it more. You enjoy the world more if you've got a bit of a human lens to view it through, I find. It's one of the few criticisms to have of Half-Life is that Gordon Freeman just goes around and does whatever he's told and he doesn't seem to think or feel about anything other than what you can, like,
They do reference that in the game, though, don't they? I mean, Alex actually makes a point of it in Half-Life 2 that you're this kind of silent type.
Yes, but isn't making a little joke about it? It's kind of like it's the narrative thing of hanging a lantern on something. They know that it's a silly problem, so they point it out themselves to say that they're aware of it. It doesn't stop it from being a problem.
Yeah,
I think I prefer my protagonist to be silent. I
knew you were going to say that, Lou.
I prefer to play them. It's again kind of the open-ended role-playing thing. I want to play them how I want to play them. I think especially with Dishonored, because you've got such a choice of to play it as a good guy or a bad guy, basically. If there was a narrative to that, it would kind of have to fit one of those paths. Like, he would have to justify why he killed someone, or he'd have to justify why he wasn't killing people. It'd make it very hard for the game to play out as flexibly as it does.
They do it quite well with Dowd, though. They make him quite ambiguous, even though he is the person who killed.
He's very philosophical, isn't he?
I suppose you could class him as that. I thought it meant he's grey in the way that he speaks. Obviously, the dialogue doesn't change based on your decisions, but he's very grey in terms of he says that he's not sure. He regrets, or no, actually, he doesn't even say he regrets. He says at the beginning that he's not sure how killing the Empress affected him. If you know what I mean, they don't say I didn't like doing. It affected me negatively or positively. But so it gives you the control, but it also gives him some character. So they've been quite clever with the dialogue. I don't know where I sit with this. I don't know which side I sit on because I quite like both.
I think it completely depends on the game. Case in point, the Witcher wouldn't work if he was completely silent.
I agree, and I enjoy Geralt as a character.
But Geralt.
There are two games that I've played previously that I wish the protagonist would have shut the fuck up. One is it Alex Mercer from Prototype?
Hmm. He doesn't talk that much, from what
I
remember.
I'm sure he talks and he's a tit.
He says some lame stuff like, I don't know what you are, but I know I'm going to kill you. he does say some pretty lame things.
And then there's Connor from Assassin's Creed 3 who can just fuck off and die. He's such a whiny bitch.
Yes, but that's an argument against writing bad characters, not against having a character who says things. Because Ezio talked a lot as well, but I liked him and he was quite cool.
I agree, yeah. But no, that's what I'm saying. They probably would have done better if Connor didn't talk in Assassin's Creed 3. For me, he didn't need to. Everyone else could basically told him what to do anyway, and he went, but actually, I don't actually care about my people. I care about myself, etc.
It's one of these things where it can take it too far as well, because you know, if you're in like an awkward situation with someone and they feel they need to make small talk.
Hmm.
And it's just completely irrelevant, which actually makes it even more awkward.
Like the show, yeah.
Yeah, it's what was it?
My favourite colour is blue, by the way. Oh, sorry.
I like blue. It's good that.
Oh, what's like the Uncharted series? Like when you're walking round with Nate.
Fuck off,
and
Uncharted.
You just go, ooh, it's cold out tonight. You don't need to say that.
I quite like those bits in Uncharted. Actually, I like it because he'll say like random things, which I quite like, because they're selling the idea that you're playing as a person, not as a computer game character.
Yeah, but how often when you're wandering around, you know, Istanbul on your own in the middle of the night, do you start commenting on the weather aloud?
It's a game trope, this, isn't it? When you start to hear the same line over and over again.
How many times are you controlled by a third person godlike entity, though?
All the time.
All the time.
What in what respect?
Well, I'm controlling myself now.
You're not a third person, Lou, if you haven't figured that out.
There is certainly a balance to be struck, but I quite like the moments, again, when the little moments where Nathan Drake might say something that you might actually be thinking, like you'll be in a ridiculous firefight and reinforcements will turn up and he'll be like, oh, God's sake, how many of them are there? Which is the sort of thing I might say. So I quite like those little moments. I think those things actually work.
Well, whenever that happens in a game, I'm like, yes, thank God, more fodder for me to spend hours and waste hours on this one particular scene on. I can't wait. That's what I think, so I'm not on with that.
That comes down to a matter of opinion, I suppose. Yeah.
It comes down to how it's been implemented.
It does, but they're doing that with the Fallout 4 as well, taking a game that was previously a silent protagonist who you had dialogue options for, and now it looks like they're going to be fully voiced for both the male and female,
right,
with like a round... That gameplay thing that you shared, is that had the little thing where he talks to the robot and it has the little four dialogue options. Now, a lot of people are like, oh, Mass Effect dialogue, fucking...
They don't need that in Fallout, though. That's the thing. Silent protagonists in Fallout, Skyrim, those kind of big RPGs, that's where the silent protagonist shines in my eyes.
I agree. And I'm still up for Fallout 4, but that thing makes it not quite as Fallout-y.
Hmm. Speaking of other games that I've played that have talking protagonists and quite well scripted stuff as well, I've been playing Last of Us Remastered again a little bit more. I had a good old sesh on it last Friday, I think.
Where are you up to?
Right.
What's the difference between The Last of Us and The Last of Us Remastered?
It's 1080p.
It wasn't
the original.
No, it was 720. I think it was 720 on the PS3.
They've done a few little touch-ups. It's not graphically that much different. It's just like a remaster. They've done quite a lot of remasters for last-gen games, though.
I have to be honest, the graphics are really nice on it. I mean, you know I'm not a fan of Naughty Dog in general. I don't like Uncharted. I don't like the movie narrative, I suppose, with their games. I have to be honest, I'm finding it hard to complete Last of Us. I'm finding it hard to keep pushing with it. I'm sure it's brilliant, you know. I'm sure it's brilliant as a story, but I want to play a game, you know. I want to experience a game. I feel like it's constantly pushing me down a route that I don't really want to follow. I want to go off and find something. I want to go and do my own thing instead of going, right, I need the next cutscene. That's what drives me up the wall about these games, the linear experiences. Yeah, whatever.
The Last of Us and The Last of Us Remastered both run at the same resolution.
Yeah?
I'm just curious to know where you're up to in it, though. What's the last bit that happened?
So, I'm trying to think. This makes awesome viewing, so I'll move on. I can't remember.
I there's loads of people that really hate that kind of gameplay, but I don't really mind it. I don't mind it going from section to section and having a good time along the way. I don't really understand why some people are so against it. It's like, to be fair, The Last of Us, you're not always going down one little route. There are some gameplay areas that are quite large and open. You're going from place to place, yeah. But it's not an open world game, and it was never advertised as such. Not every game has to be open world either.
I just remembered where I'm up to. I've just done. We've just found there's a black guy and his little kid. I've just found, and his little kid's just been turned into a zombie.
He's just, spoilers.
Yeah. Well, fucking hell. It's a zombie game turned into a zombie. Sorry. Anyway,
that just happened, and
I've just. He wants to find the Fireflies or something, so we've just kind of started on that journey or something. That's where I'm up to.
All right, so, yeah. Okay, cool. So you get into, like...
the end-ish.
Probably about two-thirds of the way through, I guess.
And I'm going to plow on with it, because, you know, it's good enough, and the missus enjoys watching me play it, so it's one of those that I'm going to finish, but... I'm not enjoying it as much as I could, you know, with other games. I'd rather be playing something like Terraria. I'd rather be playing something like Witcher, you know. Even though The Witcher's fairly linear as well, so... But it's different, I don't know. Different in a different way. Last game I've been playing, which I've been playing for quite some time, and it's my toilet game, is Plants vs. Zombies 2, which I'm really getting into, actually. I was slating it at the beginning.
I sure remember you slating that a few weeks ago.
I was slating it as a pay-to-win type title. Because the first one was pretty much, it was just, here you go, here's a tower defense game with a bit of a difference, you know, with lanes and things like that, and get on with it, you know, you upgrade, you get better plants as you go along. But this one, it doesn't force you. When you get into how this game works, it's slightly different from the first one in that it's a lot more frantic. As you open more plants, you can have, like, area effect, damage and things like that, instead of single lane shooting, or you can shoot three lanes at once, or you can kill certain zombies and get power ups and stuff. But you don't have to spend any money on it in order to play it all the way through to completion. It just takes a little bit of understanding, and I'm actually really, really enjoying it, to the point where I've been bringing the tablet out the toilet and playing it, you know.
It's escaped from the toilet.
In the real world.
It has a little bit, yes. Not too much, but it's basically only when I haven't completed something and I've been like, right, I've got to get this last bit. There's loads of worlds in it as well. I think I've completed about 5 of the worlds. There's 25 levels in each world. And then there's maybe another 4 or 5 left, something like that. Okay, so shall we move on?
Yes.
Shall we move on now? We've got a few new things to talk about here.
Birthday stuff.
Yeah, birthday stuff. I mean, we've got a bit of a list section later on, as we normally do, but we're just gonna go over some things that we've done this year. I've put this in the wrong place, so I'm a bit confused as to how to announce this section. So,
well, as well as the main show that we do on Wednesdays, we've also done some kind of offshoots. We've done periodicals that we put onto YouTube and some live streams and things as well. It's mainly been the stuff that we've pre-recorded and put out. And the biggest of those has been our Metal Gear Solid charity playthrough, Deathathon.
Yeah, which we haven't actually donated that money to charity yet, but I've still got a note of all of the individual donations that we've had. And then there's Lou, who's going to be...
We said that we'd like to at least do, to round cop off that series and then maybe draw a line under it, Metal Gear Solid 4 at some point, and then tally up the death total and then do it, and then you can do Peace Walker in 5 in your own time. I mean, you might, because obviously 5's going to be out before you even get to Peace Walker, most likely, so you're best off, if anything, just reading the quick wiki, like, rundown of the plot from that. So you
do
know
I need
the hell...
to, though? Do I really need to?
Even if it's the Metal Gear Solid game, mate, you're going to want to know what happened in Peace Walker. Metal Gear Solid 5 is being clearly set to be a direct sequel with huge consequences from Peace Walker.
Right, okay.
Like, a lot of the characters and things are directly from Peace Walker. So, there you go.
Fair enough.
Go on.
I was just going to say, on top of the other videos that we've done a few, I've put a few Witcher 3 videos up, which are just basically 10-minute battles or 5 minute battles and this, that, and the other.
It's you showing off, isn't it, Chris? It's you not losing any health.
Pretty much, yeah.
Insane regen.
Even though I get hit as well.
I watched one of those battles and your health never moved throughout the entire battle. Not once. It didn't even go down in the strip back up again. It just didn't move.
Did you see how many
God mode on?
Did you see how many potions I had though? All the potions were basically I might have been fighting a basilisk that when it poisons you, if I'm using golden aureoli and I fight a basilisk, it poisons you. When it poisons you, your health goes up with a golden aureoli potion on. So it's like whatever.
Whatever, mate.
Yeah, and then you have use all of the decoctions as well. If you use the right ones for the right battles.
Yeah, it helps regenerate only when it's cloudy on a Tuesday at 3:30.
Yeah.
If those decoctions, I'm just like, I don't give a shit. I can't tactically wait till 3:30 on a cloudy day to fight this monster.
I've never been in a position where I'm on like at the back foot that much.
All right, that looks. Sorry. No, I'm with you there, but I just can't tend to have... Normally, I have the werewolf decoction on because I can run infinitely outside of battles without losing any adrenaline. That's the most useful, really. But there's a number of others. I think there's the... Echinaea?
Is that the one where...
Echinaea?
Where every enemy you kill gives you a bit of health or something.
There's a lot of different ones that all have slight different tweaks to them, and some of them I like, some of them are pointless. But I was kind of showing off, I suppose, with those videos. But anyway, they're on YouTube if you want to go and have a look at them. They're probably our shortest videos that we've done. We also
did a bit of Savage Lands as well, which was fun for a while. That was just you and I, Chris, wasn't it?
No, Ste had a play with us as well one session.
Did he?
Is Savage Lands the one where you just basically spent the whole time going, where are you? I'm over here by this rock.
Fuck's sake, right.
We could have looked at our map or something, but we were basically running around the coast.
Did you not? Yeah. Sorry, okay.
It was just us two.
Yeah.
It was Planet Explorers that we played.
Yeah.
Where we spent half an hour going, where are you?
At least with a map and a GPS on that.
What keys to the inventory for? How do you build a platform? What's a platform? Do you have to be flat? Etc. Etc.
Exciting viewing, folks. Make sure you check it out.
Yeah.
Some of the most exciting viewing was Farming Simulator.
That was quite funny, actually.
Maybe not for watching, but I thoroughly enjoyed that, and we actually had a good laugh playing Farming Simulator.
The highlight of that for me was delivering individual eggs to a town.
I actually like the fact I had to drive 200 miles to drop off a fucking bag of canola.
I had to walk from the farm to the house to put an egg in it.
You know what?
That's what Lou was getting, like $50 per egg delivered by hand.
Obviously, a Lou egg.
The most exciting part of any of these videos that we've done though is finding out how games worked. You know, how the mechanics are, especially for the indie games where there's usually lacking documentation. I'd have loved to really, get us all into Terraria originally and learn how to do Terraria, because I learned Terraria on my own, but yeah, I kind of taught you when you came in, Lou, and then I think we did the same with you, Ste, even though you haven't been as involved in Terraria as me.
You taught Lou, and then just completely neither of you has taught me anything.
It's because you don't listen.
Now, like hell when I do something that I don't...
That I shouldn't do, drop a ball. Right.
We're going through the cavern section.
Right, hang on, listen to this, and tell me if I'm stupid or he's stupid.
And then Chris, I said to Chris, there's a switch over there that I saw, and he went, all right, if you jump on that, it explodes, or it sets off an explosion. So I jumped on it.
It was a detonator. With dynamite next to it.
Because it'll kill you. You just said, if you jump on it, it explodes.
And the thing is, right, I ran towards him, kind of going in Terraria. I kind of ran towards him going, no! And I exploded as well. He fucking jumped on it and I got in the radius.
I mustn't have been around for that.
This was last night before. The night before. You were off bumming, doing what you do.
Yeah, but unless you tell people these things, how do they know?
Mate, there's about 500 billion things to tell you in these games. And
it's like when we're in the base and I walk past a switch. So I press it.
Well, yeah, look, I just put the Switch down, just wired it up, right? And we were creating in Terraria, there's a few different like tricks you can do to it. There's one of them is you can create like an obsidian generator, which is lava and water together, and then you can mine the obsidian, and you can basically get an infinite obsidian, and that will give you, well, infinite as long as you've got someone to keep getting lava, creating lava from the infinite water bug or the infinite liquid bug. But if you mine that, you can make loads of money. Now, this particular one that we're doing is we had loads of little chambers that we'd just built. Me and Lou had spent ages building these chambers. Put some statues in it for... they're like 5x5 chambers, so they're quite hard to maneuver, even if there's nothing in them. These statues, when you wire them up to a switch, they spawn enemies. If you turn the switch on and you turn on like a timer or something like that, so every second it'll spawn a skeleton or a jellyfish or a crab or something like that, and you can get items from them. And again, it's another way to make money. So he fucking turns a switch on while I'm in this 5x5 chamber with just enough room for me to breathe, let alone get out of it. 10 fucking skeletons spawn, start knacking me. I start killing them, but every second another one's fucking spawning. I can't get out of this thing, and I'm like, turn it off!
The fundamental engineering mistake here that Chris made was that he wired it up, then stood inside the room.
Yeah. Any electricians that are watching the show will know that you isolate the power before you play around.
Yeah, sure. This is equivalent to basically sticking your screwdriver in the back of a TV while it's switched on.
I was running around on top of lava. It wasn't exactly health and safety, was it? You know. Anyway, so that went wrong, but it's still it's a bit fun, but it's also like, come on, mate, for fuck's sake. He didn't turn it off for ages as well. He just left it on and went, what's going on? And I'm going, fucking hell, mate, turn it back off!
Yeah,
it also made the best noise in the world.
That's why I kept saying, saying to you and Lou, don't play it without me, because...
No.
Although you're claiming you're not doing nothing, you're learning all this stuff.
No, well, I already knew all this stuff from playing on my own. This is stuff that I learned last time I played it, ages and ages ago. There are things...
Like Lou knows because you've taught him, or because he's
Most of the stuff that Chris and I do together is stuff that we did last time. It's just getting generators built and stuff.
To be fair, Steve, you were in that game. No, you weren't, but you weren't. We didn't agree last time we were going to play them all together. So anyway, let's keep the domestics off the show. We've already went through it before. What else have we played? Well, we did Ludum Dare. We didn't exactly play anything, but me and Lou spent a weekend, and we've got on our YouTube channel, we've got a time lapse of the 48 or 72 hour Ludum Dare game jam.
Complete with bonus little dances in every so often.
Yes, and me doing this. Fucking 72 hours of me doing that. we produced a game from that called Charnhell, which is broken to fuck.
Yeah.
But it's out there if you ever want to look at it and look at the source code.
No one knows how to play it.
No, that was the problem as well. We didn't really provide enough user interface, I suppose, or there's a number of things we learned from that anyway, put it that way. But it's all about the time, isn't it, with these kind of games? GTA Online, we did one or two videos of that, not much, but you guys got bored before we went any further with it.
I think we all got bored together, to be honest.
I really still want to play it. I still want to really go through the heists.
The Witcher came out.
There is that, but I still do want to do the heists in that game.
At some point, we will. Once they've fixed everything.
Do you think they ever will, though? They keep releasing new content and everybody's slating GTA Online these
days. I think it's fundamentally unfixable. I think that it just doesn't work. In that sort of multiplayer gaming doesn't work in that sort of large-scale domain.
I think they could have implemented a lot of things differently and made it better. They could have made it so, for example, death matches weren't in an instance and they happened in the game itself, and people, you know, just running around in the game could probably interfere with it. I think that would make it a bit more interesting, at least. Well, then if they interfered, then they'd get involved in the game somehow. I don't know. There's lots of things.
I actually think the whole game would have worked better if it was entirely instance. And in fact, it was small sections of the world that you have to play missions in.
Well, that's how it works.
Well, it does work that, but you've also got by extension, that makes the free run mode kind of pointless, because all the gameplay that you do is in all the matches and everything you do is all done in an isolated environment. So then you've got the whole open world bit. It's essentially superfluous to the experience then.
See, my memories of playing GTA Online were basically me either trying to find Chris Chris trying to find me, and then us just trying to play something online.
Yeah, and then with each other, realizing forever. We didn't actually need to find each other anyway in order to play something. We could have just invited each other into the lobbies. But then you've got the chance of Steve's game breaking, or my game breaking, or crashing, or being kicked out of the lobby because it's Tuesday, you know.
Yeah. And then you'd go back into the, you know, the main session, and then you'd be in a completely different server to the person you originally
were
with.
Yeah, so we had that a few times as well, didn't we?
Or you'd fail the mission early on, and then have to wait like 10 minutes for it all to reload and do it again.
And yeah, and there's also the GTA loading screen, isn't there? So yeah,
wasn't good.
But it could have been so good. That's the thing, I think.
Single player game, excellent though.
Can't deny that.
Still a great single player game. I still think that San Andreas is my favourite out of all of them, but I like GTA 5 a hell of a lot. A lot of it to do with San Andreas is the fact that I love the soundtrack as well. The fact that you've got better songs on the radio as you're spending 70 hours on the game makes those 70 hours more enjoyable.
That's why I like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2, because of the soundtrack, and it's an awesome game, but I bet 3 and 4 probably play better in general from my experience. I think I played 3 and 4 as well as 2. Didn't play first one though.
The one thing I want to add just about our other videos is specifically the Metal Gear Solid ones. I have actually watched a couple of those, and they're genuinely quite amusing. For people that haven't watched them and may have just watched this and thought, I don't really want to watch these guys play Metal Gear Solid. If you love Metal Gear Solid, you'll probably quite enjoy it. If you hate Metal Gear Solid, you'll probably also quite enjoy it. Because as much as we bum the game, we're also ruthless with it. Like,
pretty
much the videos
badly,
we've shipped. Like, Chris and I have probably criticised the game more heavily than Steve and Lou have, and we're the fans. Plus, lots of very, very bad Snake impressions, and lots of Chris running around with a machine gun, killing everybody in a stealth game. I tell you what, those Metal Gear Solid things. Funny.
And lots of me getting post-traumatic stress disorder and clinical depression from being fed up of playing it as well. Because it gets to a point where even though you guys aren't actually playing it and you're still engaged, it's quite laborious to play if you play it for extended periods sometimes.
The only thing that I really learned from watching you play Metal Gear Solid is that you can't play Metal Gear Solid.
Fuck off. You know what? We've had this
discussion, Chris.
Yeah, all right.
I will take up the gauntlet.
What, a play 4?
No, I will play a game.
All right, okay.
I've never played Metal Gear Solid. I'm not going to start now.
All right, well, we've got 4 to play, but I'm happy to play another game at any point with you guys. And Lou says he would as well, but you know what, Mr. Let Down Lou.
Yeah, Let Down
Lou. Lewis Let Down Lou. Lane. Lewis Let Down Lou? Where the fuck did that come from?
He just sweats disappointment.
He does. So, the only other game, as you've already mentioned, Steve, is Planet Explorers, where we were kind of just flailing around.
That was quite entertaining.
It was entertaining.
Short time.
I'm not sure if it's finished or we get any. Did we achieve anything? I think we have ended up loading like flying prefabs, didn't we? And just ended up flying them into each other, and then getting killed by something that just randomly spawned in front of us.
We made a shit house like 7 days.
Yeah, we made some jets. Then Lou spawned in and got killed by loads of giant aliens.
We took over a village as well, didn't we? At one point, and I killed everything. But the AI was awful. What was that thing? It was that UFO thing, wasn't it? That was
that
fucking huge UFO that just suddenly spawned one day, and it's like what? I looked at it and got nailed, evaporated. Hello to Melvin in chat. Hello, thank you for engaging with us,
Mr. Melvin.
Yes, Mr. Melvin. Okay, so going forward, I just wanted to quickly ask the audience, for those who have watched the show, or those who are just watching for the first time ever today, what things we've done right and what things we've done wrong, I suppose.
I just remembered something.
Go on.
What?
I've played another game this week.
Oh, well we can't talk about that now. We can't talk about that now. So going forward, we wanted to kind of ask your opinion as to what we've done right, what we've done wrong, where we can improve, and I suppose we're all limited for time. That's the reason that we do these two-hour shows on Wednesdays, you see. We don't really want to be it's not that we don't want to, we don't really have the time to do lots and lots and lots of videos. That's the issue. As much as I'd love to spend my entire life doing this, there is such a thing as real life going on with
Damn
all
it.
Of us. So things like we've had quite a lot of different incarnations of the show. We've had guests on, I must admit, I quite enjoyed having guests on. It took quite a bit of me for me to organise them and get people involved and distribute things to the guests, etc. Organise times, etc. So it is a bit of effort, but I don't mind doing that if that was a good thing that people enjoyed. It's nice to have a different opinion as well. Always nice to have a different opinion. We've had... for a while I was showing videos. We were having a few content problems with YouTube when that happened, monetization issues, which you guys don't care about, but obviously if we can make any money from this, we would like to at some point, but it's very, very, very minimal, and it's getting worse and worse and worse on YouTube anyway, so it's not that much of a problem, to be fair. But if
maybe
that was
YouTube
working
Gaming
for...
will change that a bit.
Maybe. So there's also we've also done some offline videos. We've had a few requests from people to do live streams more often, but the problem with live streams is that it's setting them up and organising them properly. It's difficult for us to do them at a time that people are going to come and watch, you know, and anything that's regular as well. Because when we do play games together, it's usually sporadic, you know, we can't get everyone on together, and obviously Sam's not involved in that either, so we're in a bit of a weird situation with that. But so I said, yeah, we showed videos, we also showed stills, we had things like that. Did that work? Was that good for people watching the show? Was it more engaging? Watching some of those videos back, I thought they were it was quite good, but that took time out of me and took my kind of input away from the show as well.
Do you mean the videos as in the videos that we used to put into the show as we were talking about things?
Yeah.
Part of me kind of misses that in a way, but yeah, it kind of meant that we had to then either all sit there watching the video or...
There's actually now, we've actually got a better way of doing that now because of the way that I share my screen with you guys. I wouldn't need to share the video separately. As I flip, you know, as I show... Basically, you see what goes out to the show now. Live essentially, before you don't have to watch the stream. There's a few other things as well we've done. We've talked about the Let's Plays. No, we haven't. That's it. That's everything we've done. They're all the variations. We've actually got into a bit more of a refined state with the show, at least. But in terms of other things, have you guys got any opinions, Steve, Sam, and Lou, about this?
Go on, Lou.
Go on, Sam. Go on, Sam.
I feel like I've spoken a lot. You go.
I did really like when we did the videos on them, but I know that it took a lot of time, and I think it's more important that you've got your input into the thing as well, Chris, rather than being basically the DJ for the videos, or the VG, I guess.
Yeah. Well, there is maybe a way around that. We might be able to engage somebody else to do that kind of thing, potentially, to produce essentially while we talk. I don't know if that's something somebody out there would be interested in doing, or...
A suggestion I had a few weeks ago, and I still stand by this, is that we could get people who are watching to kind of phone in, I guess, to join in the conversation, to talk to people as well while they're watching. I still think that would be really nice. I would like to hear from the people in chat.
I agree, but that would take quite a lot of administration and effort.
It would. That would need someone in the background as well. It's like running a live TV show or a radio show. You need someone to handle all that and set it all up.
Tom's talking.
Yeah, I was going to say, you basically would need a producer, wouldn't you, to do those kind of things. Someone who's not on the show, isn't speaking, but is just sat there doing the stuff to make it all run.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree that it's better. Even though the videos were a nice little thing to have, it was a case of you were always doing stuff with them and you couldn't really talk about them. Even if it's a video that you had, like, brought up, you were then having to just maintain it. Yeah. Rather than actually discuss it, so it's kind of a pro and a con. The whole point of the show is to have discussing the stuff, and if one of us is just organizing videos, as nice as they are to have, it takes that away a bit.
So what about we've discussed the length of the show a number of times as well. It's 2 hours. Everybody knows that that nobody wants to listen for 2 hours, really. I mean, I do. I listen to podcasts. I listen to 4-hour podcasts occasionally if I'm in the right mood for them, but not everybody's up for that. And do we provide the right kind of content for 2 hours worth of show, you know?
Well, would people prefer to do like 2 1-hour shows or something? That'd be probably harder logistically for us to get together twice a week.
We wouldn't be able to do 2 shows as things stand. That's a problem. We struggle to play games together leisurely, you know, as it stands.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
It's. I think we will have to stick to one show. We could do an hour. We could just have one show where we don't do something live, and we just do on Wednesday nights. We record a few bits of gameplay, or we record a few, you know, quick bites or something like that that we then output and put on YouTube. We've got an opinion or a rant about this particular subject. Let's do it. Upload it. Go on.
One thing I was going to suggest, which I talked about ages ago when we were first doing the show, because we first started when we pick a subject. So up until, and I was looking through our old documents, I think up until about episode 21, so near enough sort of halfway to where we are now, we changed into this more, what games have you been playing, where's the exploding list, gaming news, whereas before we were like, we'll do a whole show about like gaming weapons or characters and stuff. And one of the things that we talked about then was maybe doing the odd show where we literally just go, right, let's just do a 2-hour podcast of like a dissection of just Dishonored, just do that one game, or just do like a series, like dedicate one to one subject, maybe every now and then, once in a while, just once in a blue moon, just go, we're just going to do a little bit of homework, we'll all do our own little research and have our own thoughts, and we'll just dissect one subject, not necessarily like an abstract thing like gaming characters, but just pick a game and do a retrospective on it.
I do like the idea of dissecting the game itself, or a very narrow genre or something like that.
That requires all four of us to have played the game, for one.
Yes, it
and
does.
All four of us to have memory of the game as well. I mean, I loved Ocarina of Time, but I couldn't tell you everything that happened in it without playing it again.
And I'd have no input on any Zelda game.
The thing as well, games that take more than is feasibly, that you could feasibly play the game in a week in order to kind of get yourself fully up to speed with it.
But the thing is, we are not professional critics. We do not have the time to go off and play a game in order to review it or retrospective it, or to give it a retrospective rather. We do this leisurely, you know.
I suppose the only way that would work is if we were all doing something purely for pleasure, like with The Witcher, when we were all playing that just because we wanted to play it.
Yeah, we could fill an entire show with all the stuff that you...
We have.
A lot of waxed lyrical about The Witcher.
Between the times we talked about it, probably have filled about 3 or 4 shows with just The Witcher talk.
And a lot of it hasn't actually been repeated either. A lot of it has been quite original. Oh, this I found out this week. This I found... Terraria, for God's sake. I know we haven't talked actually in that much detail about it, but there is, we could be specialists on that show, on that game, for God's sake. You know,
we could talk about that game. We could talk about procedural games. We could talk about how the crafting games and you know, we could kind of branch out into that whole genre.
Yeah, and also there's things that we've all played, like the Elder Scrolls games. It doesn't have to be a specific game. It could be a franchise.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it was just a thought. The way we do the show is. It's fine and I like it, but I just thought it could be like a different thing every now and then, just for, you know, variety, shits and giggles.
Are you still thinking one big long show rather than doing a number of tidbits, essentially? You're making it shorter for people consuming online. I'm also thinking about viewership as well, because we have some regular viewers, which I will acknowledge later on, but we've got some regular viewers. We've got, you know, 70 or so people who follow us on Twitch, and some on Twitter, some on Facebook, etc. It's not a massive following. It's certainly not a massive following looking at some other podcasts. But it's a following, and it's nice. It's nice to have that. But it still suggests that we maybe could do things better, or maybe 2 hours is too long. I don't know.
Possibly. I mean, if you still wanted to go... If you want to do pre-recorded stuff, it's easy to segment things. If you're doing it live, we kind of do it off the cuff, don't we? So if you were to say, well, we'll pre-record these things, then we can sort of stop in the middle of a conversation. Like, let's say, for example, Lou's got something to say about a certain game, and like one of us steps over him a little bit by mistake. If you're pre-recording, you go, stop, start again, say what you said again clearly, and do all that shit, and make it a bit more slick. Whereas, because we're going live, we're kind of just talking off the top of our heads a lot of the time. We stumble over each other. We stumble over our own words. Those little things that happen when you go live. So if you want to make a more condensed like thing, maybe going live wouldn't be the best way to do it. But then that's the whole point of a website like Twitch, isn't it?
And I'm going to say, this is we do a live show, and we also do you know, it was also in my original intention is to spend time with you guys because we're all in different places in the country. That was my original intention here. I'm happy to continue the two-hour show. I just wondered if maybe doing smaller bits would be better for people. I don't know. And this, I'm trying to engage the audience here as well to an extent, I suppose.
Yeah, I think stick with our two-hour shows, but I think I like the idea of maybe switching it up a bit sometimes. Like, instead of doing a normal show, do a show devoted to, you know, the Fallout series or something like that. And based on, basically, we just discuss which something that we can all talk about.
Yeah.
And although Sam couldn't talk about Terraria, he certainly knows about the crafting genre, knows about procedural games.
I could play Terraria, I suppose. Everyone else seems to play it and love it.
You wouldn't have much fun with that, was. Plus, the console versions are quite different from the PC versions.
I was going to say, it's not cross-platform, is it?
No.
Can you play it? Sort of is.
Can you not? I'm sure it would run on my laptop, wouldn't it? It's not like a super high... Isn't it like a pixel art-y kind of game?
It is, yeah. I mean, it is fairly intensive, to be fair, with the amount of stuff that goes on, but it should still probably work. But, yeah.
Anyway, that's...
It is
talk
different.
Talk about that later, but yeah.
But anyway, yes, so I was kind of, to finish this little bit, I just wanted to kind of say to the audience, those people who do watch us on YouTube and those people who are watching now, what are your opinions? What do you think we can do? What do you think is the format good enough for you? Do you want more from us? Do you want smaller bits? Do you want a four-hour show? You know, for all I know, that might be what they want. Obviously, we're not going to do a four-hour show because we don't have enough bloody time to do that, but, you know... If we can maybe tweak ourselves a little bit, that's all I'm looking for, just to maybe make people a bit happier, I suppose.
One question I might ask people that happen to be watching, if there's anything you think is missing that we could do that we don't, what do you think that is? Is there something you think that we could do that we don't do now that would make it more enjoyable to watch or listen to?
Let's do it naked!
We could do it naked. Is the news section superfluous? Is it just us waffling about opinions that we have about news stories? Are you getting your news from us? Obviously, we use gaming news sites. We're not journalists, so we use gaming news sites in order to talk about news, and we paste all the links in chat and put them all on YouTube so they're acknowledged. But does that matter?
I think people watch shows for the opinions, not for the news.
Yeah,
you get
your
news from the sources that you get the news from. You find out about them. You know, I find a lot about my stuff out on Facebook. But what's important is that what we think of that and how we convey that.
I suppose, yeah, four of us is a general kind of overview of well, the male demographic, at least, for gaming demographic.
We're a very narrow demographic.
We are 30, very narrow.
30-something northern males.
Yeah, English northern males, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's move on then. We were going to, instead of having our Way of the Exploding List section, no camera.
Got a fist as well.
Next week. We're going to do something slightly different here. So normally we'd have a list section where we just talk about a list for 15 minutes or so. This week we're going to talk about the best games that we've played over the last year, the worst games that we've played over the last year, and our favourite kind of gaming announcement, etc., or gaming news thing that's happened over the last year. And we're not talking about 2015, it's since we started, so...
That was this time last year.
Yeah, about July, since July last year. These also aren't just releases as well, these are games that we've played since we started the show.
Yeah.
So let's start off with worst then. Worst game that you have played this year?
Right, I've got one, but it's not the worst game that I've played this year, but it's certainly the biggest disappointment this year.
Okay.
And that was Elite Dangerous.
Oh.
Now, I bought a lot of kit for that. I bought a really good joystick setup. I bought a track IR. And when I first started playing it, it was amazing, especially with the Oculus Rift. You know, really flying around in space, doing spaceship was just cool. Docking was amazing. But then it just started to dawn on me that there was not much to do in it. The combat was very samey. The trading was pretty laborious. The exploration was just like, you know, you walk into a system and you see a star that's purple or green or whatever. And you just started to realize that actually there's a giant world that maybe back in the 80s when Elite came out and people were like, oh God, you've got an entire galaxy to explore with thousands of stars and stuff. These days, it just feels empty and like pointless. And I know Greg, my friend, really, really wanted to get into it, and he played the hell out of it, but he felt the same way in the end, and that sort of was, there was just nothing to do. There was no real goal to it, and there was no feeling of any kind of progression, really.
Is it not still being developed, or is it
It's still being developed, and there's they've got this thing called CQB, I think, which Close Quarters...
Close Quarter Barry.
Yeah, but basically... Yeah, it's kind of like a supercharged version of the combat system in it, but it just doesn't have much scope, the game, sadly. It has way more scope than the original, but I think people were thinking back to the original and how they felt about that game back then, when you loaded it on a tape and it was like, you know, a few kilobytes, and you had an entire galaxy being simulated on your shitty little BBC Micro or whatever. These days, that is not as compelling and amazing.
No, it's like going back to Daggerfall, huge open worlds, but really quite boring when you think about it.
I was actually playing them. Someone's basically released something called Daggerfall Toolkit, which is basically run Daggerfall in Unity, and you can play with all the source code.
Oh, cool!
I was playing last night, and it was fantastic. Daggerfall is still a great game.
Is it though? I mean, it's
yes,
still
it
quite
is.
Empty. It's an open expanse of nothingness.
It's
with
empty,
occasional
but it's...
towns and occasional caves.
It's empty, but because you're not just constantly walking around doing nothing, because you're going to the missions really quickly and completing them really quickly, it's actually quite compelling. You can sit there and play it for hours.
I might have to have a look at this Unity thing.
Is it all the original assets?
Yeah, it loads all the assets from the game, but it basically runs in Unity and he's reprogrammed the game systems in Unity. Right. But loading all the assets. It was a custom engine that Bethesda created for Terminator Future Shock.
Right.
It's a full polygon engine. But I'll put a link in there in chat for that.
I'll definitely have to have a look at that.
I've got it all set up on mine. So
I am I'm in the process of potentially having a bit more time to do game dev again soon, so this may be something that'll get me into it, you know, I get back into playing with Unity.
Well, I was playing with it the other night trying to fix some background thing and finding it really nice to work with. But yeah, I mean, talking about Daggerfall, I thought I'd mention that.
Cool.
So that's the most disappointing game you played this year, since we've started the show?
Elite Dangerous, yeah, I think was the most disappointing for me, because I expected so much of it, and I think everyone expected quite a lot of it.
Sam or Steve?
I was really struggling to think of a game that I just found really disappointing, and then I was looking through my Steam library, and I seen Colonial Marines.
I haven't played that. I've been very lucky in my choices of games this year because I haven't played a lot of the disappointing. Watch Dogs, for example, I was all up for that. I was really, really looking forward to it.
I never bought it.
I didn't buy it because, and I'm glad I didn't because Assassin's Creed, bloody whatever it is, Unity, the latest one. It's another one that I'd nearly kind of thought about getting, maybe, possibly, but I didn't.
Do you think that is a victory for word of mouth over marketing there?
Yeah.
We all didn't buy it because straight away, as soon as it came out, people were saying it was shit. And it was like, hold your horses, maybe let's not get
any
that.
Any game that I'm not massively invested in, I do read the reviews and go to Metacritic and see what things. And I know that I've just said that, and I did buy Colonial Marines. But that was kind of like. That was. I think I was hypnotized. It was basically. It was on offer, and it was like a couple of quid. And I kind of thought. There are some positive reviews. I mean, even on Steam there's 2,081 negative, 2,454 positive. So
really,
yeah, it's kind of it is vying more towards a positive side, but it's just a horrible game.
Really, I'm surprised at that because I thought it got universally banned.
When it first came out, it was very heavily negative, but they've since fixed quite a lot of the bugs, and it is playable now. But it's just not nice. It's just not a happy place. It's just clunky. It feels cumbersome. It's not intuitive. Whenever you want to use the motion scanner, you've got to put your gun away, and you know. And it's...
Didn't they learn that from Doom 3 that you want the bloody just get some duct tape and stick the light on top of the gun?
Yeah.
Let us point the gun at things we want to shoot at, not have to scan them and then run away and pull our gun out.
I mean, graphically, it's not. Great. I mean, considering the game itself is only, what, like 2 year old?
Yeah, it was. Well, they had a really awesome E3 trailer, didn't they, for it, which was great, and it just didn't. It wasn't that even the same game when it came out.
But it's like, I don't know, like when the aliens like attack you, it's not an alien. It sounds daft, but from a game point of view, it feels like you're shooting someone dressed in an alien costume running at you. Like they just run like a human towards you.
I've read that before, yeah.
It's an alien.
Yeah, they're not. Apparently, they really don't do the xenomorph justice, and apparently that—I mean, that for me would probably be a deal breaker, having been, you know, grown up and been a massive fan of the first two Alien films.
Do we not think that the original movie didn't do it justice when at the end of it you've got some guy in a suit hanging off a rope?
Yeah, but that was like in the '70s.
Yeah.
But you have to remember that bit is for like 10 seconds of what a 2-hour film that had been filled with like gripping tension. And they really didn't. They only showed you little bits and pieces of the alien, either in the shadows or a bit of its claw or its head. So they actually played that game really well in the first Alien, made it very tense and unnerving. They kept it as the other, the uncanny monster that you can't quite, you know, recognize. Yeah, the bit where it's dangling off the back of the ship and it's like, bah! At the end, it's a bit daft. But it's at the very end as well. So the tension has already been released because she's like knocked out of the airlock.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's not getting to talk about Alien as a movie, but yeah, the Xenomorph is a cool cinematic, you know, icon, and Colonial Marines fucked it up.
Yeah.
So, Sam?
It's weird to say this because this is a game that I actually played through to the end, but by the time I got to the end of it, I was just like, and now I'm doing this, and I kill the bad man, and done.
Yeah.
Far Cry 4.
Oh, right.
A game that I got so into because at the start, because I was like, wow, like the luscious graphics and the world, and I was like, I was quite getting to the soundtrack and the ambience, and I quite liked all that, and then I was like, wow, this main protagonist is really rubbish. Wow, Pagan Min's like really, really fucking annoying, like one of the worst villains I've ever encountered in a game. Just like he's the epitome of the sort of camp posh dickhead. You keep saying annoying things to you in the headpiece for some reason. It's like, why did they go down that route? And I played it through to the end, but yeah, I got to the end. It was mechanically like, I'll kill you, make a bigger wallet, there's a thing, shoot that, fucking go in a Jeep, done, credits, right, stop playing it now.
Yeah, that's kind of how I felt about it. It's another game that I skipped, and I'm glad I did, because didn't get great reviews, did it?
For a game that is so similar to Far Cry 3, it couldn't be more different in terms of how it affected me. Like, Far Cry 3 was completely out of the blue, and it was brilliant. It was one of my favourite games. Far Cry 4 was the same game, but looked better, but was so much worse.
I can't put my finger on it. I think it has to come down to somewhere to do with the narrative and the character, because... I'm not saying Jason Brody was a great character, my favourite, but at least he was. At least he was a character, though. At least he had something. I could get into the whole idea that this guy was a bit of a thrill seeker anyway, got sucked into this life of like being the Rakyat, the Tatal, the power, the guns, the You know, I could understand that he got sucked into that, and because so did I. That was the point. You were vicariously having the thrills that Jason was getting going around killing everybody. It wasn't the same in Far Cry 4.
Have you played Far Cry 3 a couple of times through?
I played it twice all the way through.
I've played it two or three times now. And the first time, I remember exactly that experience, getting drawn into it and going, oh, this is going to be... I'm going to be an awesome warrior by the end of this. And then the second time I played it, because obviously I know what happens at the end, I felt a little bit like he was leading me on. And it was, you know, the black guy at the very beginning. I can't remember his name now.
Dennis, I think.
That's it. Yeah. He's. I just feel like he's just a little bit like he's using me. He's just using me for his own ends. And even though that isn't really what he's doing, he's part of that whole culture and that kind of tribal instinct. I still felt like I was being burned, if you know what I mean. But I remember the experience of the first time.
That's interesting, that, because I did think that the Rakyat, they did find an outsider who could do the job for them, be essentially a sacrificial lamb, which, depending on which ending you chose, you might literally become that.
Yeah.
I think that's quite interesting, because we all got sucked into it. Knowing the outcome second time round, you go, oh, Jason, what are you walking into? First time round, we were all feeling the same, like, draw to the island.
There's also
Far Cry 4 had none of that.
There's also that whole vendetta and vengeance thing in Far Cry 3 that drives you, but you get invested in the story the first time around thinking that, right, the vendettas and the vengeance is the main drive, but I'm also helping these guys out. You know, I'm helping this tribe out. But obviously, it's all really twisted when you think about how the story actually plays out. And I quite like that.
There was some wasted potential in Far Cry 4 as well, because they had RJ as this son of this guy, whoever he was. His dad was like a revolutionary figure, and his mother was involved, and Pagan Min was involved, blah, 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 blah. And it's like the backstory of the characters that are all dead was more entertaining than the actual story I was playing through. And they kind of missed the opportunity. They had this whole you could pick which leader of the rebellion you wanted to side with in any given situation. Hmm. But because they were both so flawed and unlikable, I kind of meant to it just for the sake of which one I could have more fun doing the missions of, rather than who I actually gave a shit about being the leader. So they set up quite a few things that were just not... They didn't engross me, I just did it because I wanted to see what happened or what gameplay things I could get out of it for my own benefit, not because I gave a shit about what was going on.
I still want to play 4, but I don't want to play it. I don't want to waste my time on it if it's not going to be fun.
It's not worth it. It's not worth it.
Right.
Okay.
Beautiful game, but definitely just the game. The game itself is...
It's kind of like... You want to play it because you want to believe that it's going to be good. As in the same 3 was kind of such a surprise.
The same applies to Colonial Marines. The same applies to every single fucking Assassin's Creed title to me. I know you guys, Ste and Lou specifically, aren't that much fans of Assassin's Creed, but I do like
it. Didn't sound like you either, Chris. You never actually say anything good about Assassin's Creed
because
ever.
It's brilliant, but it's the same fucking game every time, and they've done 500 of them now. That's the problem.
It's brilliant, but it's shit, and I hate it.
I love the story behind it, though, but it is getting a bit weird now. I mean, the last time I played it was 4, and it was just like 4, brilliant game. I can categorically say that is a very good game, but they literally just shoehorned. So I haven't completed it, so I don't know what happens at the end, but they literally just shoehorned pirates into it just to do a pirate game, you know? And it's like, this didn't need to be a Assassin's Creed by the sounds of it, unless something happens major in the story towards the end. It's like...
I still don't get why we couldn't have just had an open world pirate game as a new IP and gone...
Because they couldn't. Because they invest so much money in the IP. That's the problem.
But they did that. They made a new IP with Watch Dogs and it was rubbish. Why didn't they just spend all that money and effort doing a cool open world pirate game that people would have... Yeah, but they're always a risk, aren't they? That's the point.
Isn't that the theory that the game was actually not an Assassin's Creed game to begin with, and then halfway through development or near the end of development they decided to slap Assassin's Creed badge on it?
Super Mario Brothers 2 wasn't a Super Mario game to start off with, and it's it's a huge departure from the rest of the series, but it's also one of the best ones in my eyes, the original Super Mario Brothers on the NES. Super Mario Brothers 2, in fact, Mario Brothers 1 wasn't even supposed to be a Mario game originally. It just ended up being one. Right,
so Chris, what about you? Have you got anything to add?
I've got a few. But I'm going to talk about one specifically. I'm going to mention one. I'm going to give one an honourable mention. I played it to completion, and I played it to death, but only because I was hoping that it would be better, and because of all of the good reviews it got, and because of all of the good... There's a game called Bastion, which is an indie game. sorry. It's an indie game, and it's like an isometric platformer. And it's just one of those games where you get progression as you go through it. You're basically the chosen one and you have to rid the land of some evil bollocks. That's basically the story.
Evil bollocks.
Yeah, it's a really cool... it's a really cool kind of voiceover all the way through. But it's speaking about you in the third person as a legend, but you're playing through it as he's speaking about what you're doing.
Yeah,
so
it's all
predestined, obviously, and it's quite linear. That's my problem with it. Anyway, that isn't my main one. Is Thief, because that was the biggest disappointment.
Thief was shit.
I've had this year because I had such high hopes for it. When I bought it, not reading any reviews, because I was invested in this, like you said, Ste, earlier. If I'm invested in a game, I'm going to get it anyway. Metal Gear Solid 5, I'm going to get it anyway. But Thief, I got it because I loved the first two. And I got it, and I played hours and hours and hours of it. In fact, let me see how many hours I played. Thief.
Should check mine, actually.
Actually, not that many. I played 9 hours of it, which is enough, though, for a main game. I think it's probably about a 20-hour game, possibly.
7 hours.
5 hours, yeah.
And I got 9 hours into it, and it just got so repetitive, and it just got... I hated the dude in it. What's his name?
Garrett.
I was going to call him Geralt again.
He's such a dick, isn't he? You just think he's like a, Yahtzee put it, he's just a discount Batman.
I didn't even like his his friends in it. You know, the people that come along and like try and help him out, or he's trying to. Nothing felt good about that game.
The thief was that much of a non-event for me. I completely forgot about it.
Yeah, well, that's I only just remembered because I was going through my Steam list and I was like, oh, Bastion, yeah, that'll probably get a mention. And then I saw Thief and I was like, ah, that's it. That's the one disappointment this year, I think, really. There's lots of others, but I've also found a load of games that I've really, really enjoyed this year as well. So let's move on to that. We have to keep this to one, maybe two. I'll let you have some honourable mentions if you want, like I did.
What's this one, sorry?
So this is your favourite or most enjoyable game, for whatever reason. So I'm going to let Sam go first on this one.
Well, we all know, I think, what at least three of us are going to probably come round to. So I'm going to go with a different one just because we were going to talk about The Witcher so much. Anyway.
I'll take Oscar politics right there.
Bloodborne I was really, really loving it all the way through. So anybody that doesn't already know about Bloodborne, I don't know where you've been for the past like 3 months. But yeah, Bloodborne was a really, really enjoyable experience. You have to be into that kind of Souls game mentality of the sort of really unforgiving challenge. But there's something very rewarding about overcoming that challenge. Completing a computer game doesn't really achieve anything, but you get a sense of achievement from beating that bastard boss that you were like, whoa, and then you kill it and it's great. Really great, like such beautiful level design. Like these guys could teach so many other developers a thing or two about telling your narrative through the world, just letting the world be a character and speaking for itself as a telling the story that you try to tell. Really cool, immensely fun game that I'll probably going to go back to at some point, because I've been back to the other ones in the series for a little dabble.
I'm going to let everybody mention a few honourable mentions if you've got any that were really good games. Obviously, don't go into too much detail, but is there anything else, Sam, that you can think of?
One that we actually talked about in our very first episode, and because the sequel, I haven't gone back to it yet, Hotline Miami. That was one of the games that was in the first one we talked about, because I think it was just me, Lou and Chris for a bit then. I mean, we'd all been playing it. I think we all talked about it. That's still a really good, fun game. And obviously, I'm not sure, it wasn't new at the time, but it was new to us, like as we played it. But a lot of fun, really fast-paced, ridiculously violent combat. A really weird, like techno soundtrack, which is not my genre of music at all, but perfect for the atmosphere they were trying to create in the game. A really weird story as well, like quite an interestingly strange, twisted like thing. Yeah. Immensely good fun. Obviously The Witcher 3, but other people are going to talk about that, so I'll let them jump onto that. But that's my two that I'm going to go with that were the most fun for me.
So, Steve?
The Witcher 3. Fantastic game. Catapulted the franchise way, way, way above, over and above what it was before.
Let's just hope it doesn't give them two big boots, though. That's what I'm a little bit worried about.
It is a possibility. I mean, they did make the statement that they wouldn't be making a sequel to this game. That doesn't rule out them making prequels.
Doesn't rule out. Have they still got the IP for it? Doesn't rule out the publisher.
They're still in the IP. Well, they don't own the IP, but they own the rights to the creating computer games from the IP.
Right. Okay. Okay. So that might be safe then, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, they said that it was going to be the last in the series for Geralt.
Yeah. But that doesn't mean. They said that about Mass Effect 3, didn't they? You know?
Yeah. And they'll, if there's enough money, like potential there for it, then they'll find a way around it. I mean, we've spoke at massive lengths about The Witcher and all the things it does right and all the things it managed to achieve with a minuscule budget compared to all the shortfalls that a lot of AAA titles have had with, you know, 10, 15 times the amount of money.
Yep.
So I think not only is it a success in the fact of that it is a fantastic game to play, it's a success that it is. It's kind of it's changed the paradigm slightly about what it takes to be a blockbuster game now.
It won't. It won't change the AAA industry.
I think what it might do though is it might spare on a few of the. CD Projekt Red, you wouldn't exactly call them a traditional indie developer.
No,
because they had titles before, but they weren't exactly up there either.
But Team 17 are classed as indie, and they've been around forever, and you wouldn't really look at them as an indie studio.
Nah, I suppose. But I just think that with stuff like this happening, it proves that it is still possible to do these things with a reasonable budget.
Yeah. I agree with that.
I totally agree.
You know, without you know the 500 million that it cost for Grand Theft Auto, or the 700 million that Destiny took, or you know.
I think what it's showing is that you don't have to just rely on people like Blizzard or Bethesda to make these huge games. Now, there are other people who have the skill and the technology to be able to crank out games which are on par with those developers.
Mm. Oh, definitely, yeah.
I think as well what they've done, because we are going to talk about it. What I like that they've done is all the stuff that we've talked about in their releases and the things that they've done is how they've been open and welcoming to the criticisms of their own community, taken them on board and responded accordingly. They've treated the fans of their game like they give a shit about them, which is really nice. And it's not something that you see that much, especially from again you've got your big you know Ubisofts and EA saying. Pay for our, you know, join our stupid online mandatory service, and then the game won't work anyway. So fuck you. You've already paid for it. Hmm. They've gone, no, actually, we'll put this patch in there. We'll make the UI a little bit better for you because this, that, and the other. We'll do this with your item management. Fix these bugs. Do these patches for free. Obviously, it's just nice. They've treated their own audience with a little bit of respect, and it's nice that they've done that.
That's exactly what I was that I was trying to get when I said that they've changed the power. You know, they've kind of changed the way that these things. Well, they haven't changed it, but they've introduced a new avenue where, you know, the customer is right and the feedback that they get from the community is important. It's not just, it's obviously always about the money, but it's not just about the money.
Well, if it was just about the money, they'd be chasing movie deals, they'd be chasing...
Of course they would be.
But then again, that's up to the person who owns the IP, which I imagine is the original publisher of the series.
I'm sure Uwe Boll has already been on the line to them.
Sorry, who was it again, Steve?
He's called Andrzej Sobowski or Sochowski.
Would that be
Andrzej? He's a Polish guy.
Andrzej, I imagine it'd be, yeah.
Andrzej or something like that, yeah.
He's Polish.
Well, he's done a very good job with that.
And the other game I want to mention that's just been re-released is Minesweeper.
Have you actually played the re-release?
I've actually got it on my phone.
Yeah, is it any good? Because I've not played it.
It's exactly the same as the original, but it's just updated graphics.
Somewhere in chat, Potato just came.
Oh, he's already been talking about Minesweeper and Solitaire. He's expanded to Solitaire that now.
Solitaire. Yeah. You need to stop playing with yourself, mate.
There's a few games. Saints Row 4. Was fantastic fun.
I've just been making a little list of my honourable mentions, and Saints Row 4's on there. It's almost, if I hadn't played my favourite, which I'll be mentioning, if I hadn't played that to death, then I think Saints Row would be up there because I had so much fun with it.
It was just a genuinely, you know, unashamed fun game.
Plenty of issues.
Of that level, do you get to run around with a massive dildo?
It's not even that. It's not even the sexual references. It's just the sheer scope and fun that you can have in that game. Even if you just want to go around collecting the bloody orbs, you can still have fun doing it somehow. But yeah.
And there's a last one, City Skylines, because although I think when I first reviewed it, I wasn't really that keen on it. I have ploughed over 50 hours into it, and I do quite. It's what SimCity should have been.
Yeah. I think that's what a lot of people thought.
The community, like the Steam, the workshop content that the community has made is just fantastic. There's a ridiculous amount of maps, buildings, assets, traffic management systems. That's all been put in there. It's it's quite intimidating to try and explore it all. Actually, there's a ridiculous amount there.
Yeah. So, Lou, what is your favourite game of the year?
So, my favourite game this year, the game that I've put the most time into, is Terraria. I'm thoroughly enjoying that to the point where I've played it twice now, starting from scratch. But it's
we've put over 200 hours into this game. I've put over 200 hours into this game. That is my first choice as well, Terraria.
But as an honourable mention, and one that none of you have mentioned, and I'm just kind of surprised actually, is Wolfenstein: The New Order, which was a brilliant single player game.
I've tried to play it 3 times now, and I get to roughly the same point, and I'm like, this is boring.
This is one of those things where... Oh, sorry, Chris.
I'm going to say it's a brilliant game. I thoroughly enjoyed it, but I just... Again, pushing me down a very linear path. There's lots of different ways to approach each problem, but it just feels a little bit like it's on rails. And
I loved how old school it was, though.
I really enjoyed Wolfenstein, but I kind of thought that was a little bit out of the scope of this because it's something that I played before we started doing the stream.
I don't know if I'm sure I played it during.
It came out the beginning of 2014.
I don't remember ever talking about it on the stream, but
because if we were doing that, then I would have mentioned South Park: The Stick of Truth because I had an awesome time playing that game. Right. But that was the beginning of 2014 as well.
I played that during the stream actually. I played it quite late, and I loved it originally. I loved getting into it. I loved feeling like I was in South Park, but kind of just petered out towards the end, and I just felt a little bit like, oh. The combat's a bit boring. I'm not really doing that much. I'm sick of running at random encounters and can't. I just want to get to the next puzzle and finish it now, you know? That's where I got to with it.
It's not a very long game, though. Anyway. Sorry.
Probably not, but I got bored. Too many other games.
Well, I didn't really enjoy it. I can't remember if I did play it during this. I'm sure I did play it within the last year, but if I didn't, then I still want to give it an honourable mention. But yeah, Terraria has it for me. Terraria is close to a kind of perfect game in the sense that you can just keep playing it and still find things to do and make your own gameplay, so you kind of temper your own enjoyment of the game.
You know, there are so many things that we miss as well. We've gone down a particular path with it. There's so many different types of armors, there's so many different types of items and weapons and accessories that we just haven't even tried to get hold of.
I think there's very... When I say a perfect game, there's not many games where the base game is so good that you can just keep adding stuff to it and it'll keep getting better. Normally, a game has a simplistic core, and if you start adding to things to it and tweaking it, it gets worse.
Hmm.
But Terraria just consistently gets better. Every time there's new stuff added to it, it's more fun. There's more things to do.
Just a little Terraria tip. Last night, I gave Steve a few tips to make things like item management a lot easier. That I've been reading the patch notes, and there's a few little things that I'll tell you next time we're in the game that make things a lot easier to play.
Some of them were very handy.
There's only like three or four of them, but the little cool things. In fact, I'll say them on the stream now. I'm not hiding from anybody, so I don't know why I'm I'm keeping it myself. If you alt and click an item in your inventory, you favorite it, and that means that you can't drop it accidentally. You can't quick stack it accidentally. So if you, say for example, you had a lot of spelunker potions, this happened to me all the time, a lot of spelunker potions, and then in my piggy bank I've got all my other spare spelunker potions. If I favourite my spelunker potions in my inventory, I will never stack them whenever I do a quick stack.
That's really handy.
That's really, really handy. Another thing is you know, there's an accessory tab on the right hand side whenever you where you put your boots and your everything else or your accessories.
Yeah.
There's the equipment tab where you put, if you click on the little chain above your accessories, your equipment tab, that takes you to where your mount is and your minecart. There's also, I didn't even realise, there's one in there for your slime hook as well, for your hook.
Yeah, that's where mine is.
I didn't even know that. I just figured that out. And on top of that, there's also two other slots in there. One's for a pet and one's for a light pet. We can actually get a light pet, and a light pet follows you around and shines light constantly, which is going to be really bloody handy, especially when you're in the dark. I know where we can go to get some light pets. We can actually go to that skeleton that runs around in the underground, the merchant dude. He sells one, but he only sells one on a full moon on Tuesdays at 2 o'clock in the morning or something bollocks like that. But we can also go to the Shadow Orbs or the Crimson Hearts and keep breaking those open, and eventually we'll get either a Crimson Heart or a Shadow Orb drop, and we can use those as light pets as well. There's loads of other mounts as well. There's the yo-yos have got a whole progression accessory progression thing as well that you can use. I haven't even explored this time round. It's there's loads of stuff. Loads of stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, there's one other thing as well. It's not that handy, but it's cool if for example we get a rare item and we're like, oh look at this, this is cool. If you open up your chat menu with enter when you're in multiplayer, and you alt click something within your inventory, it'll pop a little icon and you can paste it in chat. It's just a little cool thing for
like World of Warcraft, that isn't
it? Yeah, that kind of thing. But it's actually just an icon, so you can mouse over the icon and it shows you the stats instead of having to click it and that. Okay. So any other honourable mentions then, Lou?
No, that's it for me, I think.
Oh god. Well, you've mentioned actually all the ones I was going to talk about. Most of the ones, anyway. Obviously, my favourite is Terraria, because I've had so much fun with it. I've played more Terraria than I've played Skyrim. Oh, I haven't, you know, actually, because I actually played Skyrim before I had it in Steam. It came out in Steam, but I actually played it outside of Steam using the SKSE script plugin, and you couldn't run it directly in Steam, so it didn't log any of my hours. So the first time I played it through, which was hundreds and hundreds of hours, they haven't been logged, but I think I've logged about 170 hours now on Steam as well. So I've played more Skyrim than Terraria, but Terraria is definitely my game of this year, 100%. Even though I've been playing it since before and after, 1.3 is better than 1.2 was. Witcher 3, obviously, have to give that an honourable mention for obvious things. Saints Row 4 is on my list because, as I said, just because of the sheer amount of content in that, yeah, it doesn't feel like it's finished either. It feels quite flaky and flimsy and buggy and horrible and badly implemented, but it's still wonderful to play. I still just really enjoyed every second of it. Dungeon Keeper. I played that this year. And I played it to death this year. I know it's ancient. I've had so much fun playing that, though. And it's one that I'm going to go back to when I finish my current batch of games.
Those old Bullfrog games are all magic. They're just gold. You know, the Syndicate Wars and that and Magic Carpet. Just so good games.
I didn't play it the first time round. I didn't play Dungeon Keeper first time round at all. I missed it. I totally missed that game. And so I've discovered a new gem, and I've also want to get two at some point as well and play that. But I love it. I love them all. I love them. FTL gets another mention from me as well because I've spent quite a lot of hours ploughing into that. Loved the game. For a roguelike, even though it's extremely difficult and not that long when you think about it, I just loved the generation in it. I did have to cheat on it though, a little bit to really get my enjoyment out of it. And Prison Architect, spent a lot of time with that, a lot of time building prisons arbitrarily with no real aim apart from
because as soon as you finish it you're like, right, I want to build a new prison.
I've done it a few times already. I've been playing it again recently with the new patches. Doesn't feel much different from a year ago though. It really doesn't feel much different at all. There's a lot more options, and the single player now has more possibilities for making money. You can actually export things from your prison now as well, so when you export things you actually make some money. So it actually feels like I'm trying it at the moment, like you can actually maintain a prison instead of going into debt instantly, you know, and build the prison up slowly rather than just having to spend $1 million in a second trying to maintain all the amenities, etc. Two of the games and I'm done, and I'm sorry this list is long, but I've had quite a good year this year. Hitman Absolution. I think it's a couple of years old now, but I thoroughly enjoyed playing that. Have any of you played it?
I played the older PS2 Hitman games, like Hitman 2, Contracts and Blood Money, but I didn't play Absolution.
I've not played a Hitman game since maybe the first one. But I really, again, I got a lot out of Hitman Absolution. I like the stealth, I like the different ways you can complete each level, etc. I just enjoyed it, and it's a lovely looking game as well. It's very, very pretty, very nice looking. And the last one is Nidhogg.
Nidhogg, yes.
I had so much fun with Nidhogg. But only with friends. It's not a game I could play on my own, really. I have played it on my own, but it's not the same. So much fun. It's one of those I think we'll always bring out at LAN parties from now on,
It's a stalwart for every LAN now, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. It's going to be...
I wish there was more content for it. I wish there was more than 3 levels for it.
They may release a new one at some point.
4 levels?
4, sorry, yeah.
Whatever. The clouds one doesn't count because that's fucking annoying. It doesn't matter though. That's the point. That's the good point about it, isn't it? It's good that some of the levels are really annoying. Anyway. So, shall we move on?
Yeah. No one mentioned Grand Theft Auto 5.
That's because I didn't play it this year.
It came out in 2013. I'm guessing we all probably got it as soon as it came out and tanned it.
Played the hell out of it.
2013.
I certainly
when it got re-released for the PC, I also played through it again then.
That doesn't count. You can't count that. Sorry.
I could have said that, but you can count
like the original Dungeon Keep, which is from like 96.
Yeah, but I played it this year for the first time. That was a stipulation we made at the beginning of this list. You have to have played it
this year, yeah.
Like for the first time this year or something like that. Anyway, let's move on. So we've actually only got 10 minutes left, so let's skip the news.
We can
use this news list for next week.
So
before we close the show then, I just want to acknowledge some regulars. We want to say thank you very much to those who have come along and listened to us ramble for the last year. There's 3 people in particular we'd like to say thank to. I'm sorry if you're not on this list, but these are the 3 people that have kind of been here for most of the shows. One is currently spamming his Minesweeper bollocks in chat. And what Potato Power, we'd like to say thank you very much for you for coming back and putting up with us. And for, you know, to be fair, personally, I'd like to thank you for donating a few of your Steam games to me over the year, and letting me join in with your Terraria sessions and, you know, the other little bits and having chats and that. It's been very nice to have a friend. From this anyway. Well, there's also Mythalore, of course, as well. Mythalore was on the show too, and he's pretty much comes in every chat. For some reason he's not in today, which is very strange with it being our 1 year anniversary, but he's usually on the show of some sort. And Corpse, which he came in, he was a late comer in, but he's started to be a regular. I think he's been in this entire show, but he's not said anything today. Maybe he's just listening on his headphones and not been able to chat. But yeah, thank you to you guys, and obviously thanks to everybody else as well. And it's just that those guys are always here, really, every week.
We do whoop them.
Also as well, we did go through a period of having quite a lot of guests on the show, so I just want to give a mention to each one of the guests and thank them very much for coming on. We may very well reinstate getting guests on at some point in the future. In fact, it's something that I probably will do, because it's nice to have a fifth opinion. It's nice to have different people coming on and talking. There's a few people that came on and talked about their products and services. Some people came on just to talk about games with us. There was one in particular that came on because he runs a LAN party, and obviously with us being old school kind of 90s gamers, we've been to a lot of LAN parties in our life. That person was one of our friends called Thorno. Thorno Phyllis, as he calls, and he's probably the one of the most misanthropic people on the planet. But you know, he's worse than me. But he's a lovely lad, and he was very good to have on the show. So yeah, I just want to go through the other guests we've had. We had Matt Chellin on, who came on to basically talk about just games in general. He wasn't particularly promoting any product. We had Mike Stagbeetle Stevens from Game Over Year, which is another podcast. A lot of Southern Softies on there. And they gave us a mention, actually, on their recent show. I don't think it was a particularly special show, but they're changing their format soon. If you're interested in podcasts or even gaming content, in fact, they do some very good stuff. So get over to their YouTube channel. It's Gover Yeah, G-O-V-E-R, Yeah. On everything, I think. And I think that's the same. GameOverYear.com is their website, I believe. Patrick Moonreal Koalik. And he was an extremely chatty indie dev that we had on from Poland. Lovely lad. I've worked with him in the past on MMO Buff. And it was wonderful having him on. We will probably still have him on again in the future, because he was very talkative. And it's very nice to have that kind of guest on. We had Sam Mythalore Richards, who, as said, we gave a mention earlier to, who comes and watches the show nearly every week. But yeah, thank you very much, Sam, for coming on. He had he's another indie developer, and he had a lot of insight, you know, kind of more on the indie dev side, but he plays a lot of games as well. Drew Lonrem, I can't say his second name, and I'm really sorry, Drew. Kudanoff, and he was from Anook.com. Now, Anook.com is a social media platform for gamers specifically. We have signed up to it as Resonance Arcade. I have to be honest, it's not something that I maintain because I just do not have the time to keep maintaining all these different places. But it is, if you're into social networks and you're into specifically gaming-related social networks or gaming-related content, then Anook is very, very good for that kind of thing. You can filter out the posts and...
It was fascinating. When I looked at that, I really did want to use it. I just literally haven't had time, and I've been playing games which haven't really been current.
Yeah, the problem I have is that, yes, you can sign up for Nooks for all of the games that you like. I'm sure there's a Terraria Nook on there, for example.
I'm sure there will be.
There will be. Well, there has to be. It's got hundreds of thousands of players. But that might actually be quite interesting for us thinking about it. But it's one of those things where I generally play single player games most of the time, and if I'm playing multiplayer, I play with Lou and Steve. You know, I don't really play Dota and WoW and, you know, all of the big kind of MOBA games and MMOs,
all of those newfangled games with the pixel shaders and the pixel lighting and
pixel lighting.
All those new pixels.
It's pixel
physically based rendering. So yes, thanks to Drew for coming on. He was, again, very, very chatty, lovely American lad. We actually had a special show we didn't do Wednesday night for him because he was in America, and we needed to, I think we've got that on YouTube. Go and check that out. In fact, all of these shows are on YouTube. We had Stephen Chapman on, who is an indie developer / graphic designer, who I've been talking to as an indie dev friend for some time. Lovely lad, again, very chatty, very knowledgeable about his games, and very, very into his current gaming news knowledge, etc. Either that or he did his homework and he was just a particularly good guest that week. But yeah, he was a nice lad to have on. We had Adam Sawkins from Fortress Craft, who... You either love him or hate him.
I love him. I think he's great.
He's Marmite, this guy. But I personally love him as well. He's a very, very opinionated guy. He did Fortress Craft, the game, which is a... let's say it's...
Still doing.
Yeah, still doing. Let's say it's... I'm not going to say Minecraft clone, because it's not.
You have
to
say Minecraft, though.
It's not, though. It's not a Minecraft clone. It's a lot more advanced than Minecraft. It's got a lot more content in it in terms of being able to build mechanical devices, but I couldn't work it out when I played it. That was my problem. It was maybe too advanced or too... I won't say too advanced. Let's say too complicated at the time. He may have improved the single-player tutorials and things like that by now. I don't know. But there's also a multiplayer aspect of it as well, which he was working on when we had him on the show. Excuse me. We had a guy called Pim Stoit, I think he is. He was a quiet chap, but he had a fair few decent opinions that he came on. Again, his show is on YouTube. You can check out. We had Josie Howarth as well from MMO Buff, and who's now working for a company called Pixel Dynamo. Pixel Dynamo is like a media, gaming media outlet. To tend to focus more on the kind of technical aspects of gaming media. They were covering AMD Mantle and NVIDIA Gameworks, things like that, and going into kind of trying to get talks going on between AMD and NVIDIA about that on shows, except on the MMO Buff show that we were doing. Don't think that came to fruition, but they may have done something since then. But yeah, Josie is a... Again, very chatty. She does her own streaming and her own hosts, etc. Oh, and Mythalore's just showed up in chat. Hello, Mythalore. Thank you very much. We're nearly finished. We're just going running down. You've just missed your honourable mention. We're just going through all of the guests and people that we've had on the show over the year. In fact, I've only got one person left, and that is Thornton Phyllis, who I've already mentioned.
You already mentioned?
Yes, so that's it. Thank you very much to all of our guests, and... Obviously, as much as I hate them, I'd like to say thank you to Steve, Sam, and Lou for putting up with me wearing on
for the last year. For being a constant disappointment for the last year.
For being a constant disappointment. But at least you've given me some content to
at least I've given you some confetti.
Yes, yes. Lou actually did something this week. He put the confetti on our show. And yes, thank you to everybody who watches, and thank you to everyone else. This has been us for the last year. Hopefully, we'll be around for another year, and we'll mix things up a bit.
Hopefully, we'll talk about things next year as well.
Yes. So we might even mix next week's show up a bit. We don't know. We'll see. But thank you very much. We shall catch you next Wednesday, 7:30. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.